Okay, so I've been asked to summarise, you might say, what went on before, and what I want to do then is talk about some of the main points that were talked of yesterday, and at any time during that you can stop and question, because what I'm going to do is expand some of them and look at the ways in which they led. Well, as you saw, what we were really talking about in the first instance, and what part of what was going on, was to try to look at the ways in which we were inhabiting different situations, circumstances, countries, theories, religious practices, all sorts of things, we inevitably come up and across different boundaries. So we are Catholic and we come up against Islam, we are socialists and we come up against conservatives, we live in Poland and we have borders, well, we only have borders with three countries now. Poland's an interesting place because when I was born, for most of my life, Poland had borders with three countries, with the Czechoslovakian Socialist Republic, with the German Democratic Republic, and with the Soviet Union. Now it has borders with quite a lot of countries. And it even has a border with Russia, which wasn't very helpful, but so in Kaliningrad, it has debts of those war. Russia, Lithuania, Belarus, Ukraine, Slovakia, Czech Republic, Federal Republic of Germany. So quite a lot more. And there are many, many more borders for us to feel angry about and to feel and organise ourselves in. And what I was wanting to look at when I talked about this is a life in and out of the law is to look at the ways in which in our lives we negotiate these borders, negotiate these interactions both in our everyday life and geographical life, our political life, our religious life, our social and cultural life, and look at images of these borders which are physical, like I was giving you images of, say, the border between Mexico and the USA, and Poland and Germany, and see what sort of things that they show about so the point of these lectures is to look at law not so much as a set of doctrines, as what it is and how it's organised, what a law means in philosophy and otherwise, but something more in keeping with the way in which the centre operates, more interdisciplinary, but more of looking at what it means to, we all know what it means to inhabit the space of the law, to live like a law person, to live lawfully, and it's a problem because the word in English is problematic because there isn't a separate word in English for law and right, or what is it, a Gesetz und Recht. In English, both of these mean the same. So when Hegel wrote The Philosophy of Right, everyone's confused. Because in English, because they don't think of it as law. What I'm interested in, and right has the much more the connotation of what I'm trying to get at, what it means to live a lawful life, but not the kind of positive life of following rules, but what it means to live as though you were part of the law. And that's important because in our Western tradition, which those of you come from the West, if you think of our religious traditions, all the, shall we say, all the religions of the book, the Abrahamic religions, Islam, Judaism, and Catholicism, and Christianity, all have a huge legal component. They are, in a sense, religions of a book, and they use a book to ground themselves in, and their identity is in that. And the question then is, what does it mean to live by the book, in the book? And you can see in the New Testament how Christ has a different idea of what it means to live by the book than, say, Judaism. And in a way, it's kind of less legalistic, but nevertheless, he still says, I have come not to destroy the law, but to fulfill it. In other words, he is still saying that in some sense, we're living by the book. Now, law is, in some ways, what we think of now, from the Enlightenment, a secular religion in that sense. Well, we've moved from the Word of God, the universal Logos. We move now to the universalizing Logos of the law. And the law in that sense stands and takes over our religious proclivities. And in the Enlightenment, it's very clear. And if you think of the American Constitution, the French Constitution, they substitute, in a way, that for God. At the same time, in that way, you think then of Habermas and others, they talk about constitutional patriotism, an allegiance to the law and to the Constitution. And in all those ways, our society, rule of law and others, is a society that lives by the book. And the question is how do we live like that? And what I said yesterday, then, was to show two differing models of living like that. I gave you the story of a son of mine who wants to enter the army, and I looked at two differing ways of reacting to that. One was to ask, to make sure, by teaching him the convention, the Geneva Convention and the like, about how it is that we live, how he can be morally a good person while living in the institution, but having no opinion about the institution. And the other one was about, okay, what does it mean to be a soldier? You want to be a soldier. How do you compare that with being a teacher, with being a social worker, or something like that? There, you're not interested in whether the person lives a good life or not, but more interested in what sort of life is the life of a soldier. What sort of life, as opposed to the life of a teacher, or a banker, or in Bourke for many of you, as a lawyer. And that depends, crucially, on two differing models of what it means, of what one thinks of what law is. And I gave the example again. One might think, for example, that you want to be a killer, a murderer, and you're being a soldier because that's the best way you can do it legally. Or you might think that one of the ways of living, of you want a reason you want to be a soldier, is you want to keep the peace. And these correspond in law to do different models of law. I might want to think that I want to be a lawyer because I want to make money, because I want to do things like, or even if you have better motives, I want to be a lawyer because I want to organise society in particular ways. I want to use it as a mode of social engineering. I want to be a lawyer because we need law, because actually, if we don't have law, society will break down. In all those, I have a vision of what law is, as what I call an imperial code. An imperial code in the sense that it goes from the top down. You use law to tell people what to do, and they do it. The other model that I used was an interactive model. The idea that what law is something that's deeply embedded in our institutions of friendship, of community, and that you can't separate out the form of law from its content. In the first model, law is a means to an end. It's there to either build a better society for you or for anybody else, or for you to get money or for you to work. In the other model, law is dialogic, interactive. It's a way in which what we can do is in our lives help each other. But what that means, because it's about friendship and community, is that it is always ready to hear the voice of someone who is not heard, the weak and the vulnerable, because we're always organising ourselves in that way. The law is powerful in that way because it's ready to hear something from the outside. And I'll talk about that model of law and what it means and how we can use it in the lecture this afternoon. What I also talked about last time was, okay, what does it mean to live this particular sort of life? If we live by the book, I'm wanting to be a lawyer, it's not just a lawyer, I'm wanting to live a life of the book, which our societies want. What does it mean to live the sort of life by the book, which is one of the model, the first model? And what I did is give this image of that life, a boundary, a way in which everything within the law is enclosed in such a way that the way we live our life is solely within the law, and we see nothing from the outside. So the boundary, the wall, encloses us, and we are not open to any influence or anything from outside. It makes the world outside invisible. And we can ask ourselves two things. What does it mean to live a life like that? How can we live a life like that, where the rules, where the book tells us what to do in such a way that it makes everything else invisible? Merely what the book says. And I gave an example in our personal lives of the play, Sophocles' play, Antigone. In that play, Antigone is cast as a heroine because she stands against the state law of Creon. But actually, she is very like and makes the same, you might say, ethical mistake as Creon. Once, just as an anecdote, when I was in Poland in Łódź, I had nothing to do one afternoon, and I noticed in the theatre that we're going to show Sophocles' Antigone and the Antigone of Jean Anouilh, both together. And as I was walking into the play, I noticed in the theatre there didn't seem to be many adults. And then when I got in, it was full of high school children. And then the curtain opened and a man came out and said, "Please, we've worked really hard to get these plays together. Let us finish it in peace." And I knew that it wasn't going to be an easy ride here, because all the kids from the high schools in Łódź were coming to see him this time. And they almost got through it before they started falling apart. But the point is this, that if you think of that play, actually both Creon and Antigone are as hard and as blind as each other. You know, the story of the play briefly is that Odysseus kills himself, or is killed, or is cast out after he's been sleeping with his mother and so on. The two brothers of his uncle Creon, Eteocles and Polynices, decide to be king a year in turn. One decides he wants to be the king forever, the other one, Polynices, flees and comes back with an army from another city to take the city. So there's a civil war. Polynices is killed. Creon takes, the uncle takes over, and he refuses to give the burial rites, which is a pious duty for the religion there, to Polynices, because he's a traitor. Antigone buries him, gives him funeral rites, because she recognises that duty. And finally, Antigone is herself charged, hidden away, and she dies. And then Creon realises everything goes wrong, his son, Antigone's fiancé, kills himself, and everything falls apart. He's dead, everybody's dead. And the point is that actually in that play, both Antigone and Creon are absolutely clear as to what they've got to do. They have no worry about it, and they don't see that there is anything. They're blind. I said before, Creon sees Polynices and sees an enemy of the state whose duty it is to be cast out. So he can't look beyond the fact that he's an enemy. But Antigone sees it the other way. She doesn't see, she sees a brother and doesn't see an enemy. If you listen to what Antigone has to say, nowhere would you notice there's been a brutal and bloody civil war. If you look at Creon, nowhere would you notice that this was a relative, a brother, an uncle, a nephew. And it's interesting in a play about brothers that the word brother is not mentioned as a relation by Creon at all until he says, let this ordinance, let this rule be a brother to the other one. So he sees everything within the optic of that law. He's blind to everything outside. But then Antigone sees everything within the rules of philia, within the rules of friendship, within those sorts of rules. And she's blind to everything else outside of that. And they come and they cannot see. And this is the important thing. They cannot see that there is a difficult decision that's going to be made that's disruptive. They think the answer is obvious. They read it off from their book because that's the way they live. So one reads it off from the book of the laws of friendship and the other reads it off from the book of the laws of state. Because they can't see, they don't pay attention to something outside of that, the whole world collapses. It's because, in a way, in this example, both of them see that there is no possibility of a situation where values start clashing in a way which you can't really make a decision one way or the other. There's always something to be read off because there are always the rules that tell you what to do. And in that sense, of course, then it's obvious that things fall apart. And if you think of it in that way, then of course, if you think of law in that, if you think of the ways in which we live our social life in that way, then that's the same thing. Because what law, what Antigone and Creon have done is impose a border on the world which is so opaque, so difficult that you can't see through it. Everything is within that particular cozy world. Nothing gets there to prevent it. You just, if you keep following it, everything will be all right until it breaks down. An example of that, say, in Kafka, in his short story novella In der Strafkolonie, in the penal settlement, is where the explorer goes and finds this penal colony where there is a machine which executes people all the way. And the machine is breaking down, it keeps not doing well, and things like that. But the commandant of the penal colony believes in it, insists on it, and finally he goes into it, he's taken on it, and it breaks down as it kills him. And it imprints on his body, Sei gerecht, be just. But the point of the Kafka story is that those who live that sort of life by the book will perish or will fall apart because it destroys you in the end. Move away from literary analogies. Think about what we think of as positivism and legalism. In that, what goes on, what happens, is that we do not know. We live a life, follow the rules, they become self-generating, away from what we can do. We follow them, they're there because they're there, and they guide our lives in such a way that we do not know, and that we cannot see that they are guiding us and making us do those things. They make our world, they make our world normatively flat. They enable us to predict and organize our world. If you think of it in this way, if I, as Max Weber said, capitalism arises through the rise of science, formal rationality becomes important because as you get science and rules, you can predict what goes on. And it means that once you're able to do that, you're able to kind of to plan ahead and organize your mercantile strategy. So once you move from seeing the rain caused by the gods pissing, or thunderbolts being cast by Zeus, but to do with atmospheric conditions which can be predicted, the woods, then you can predict when your harvest is going to be good or bad. You can store up for the future. Once you see the woods as not being inhabited by tree spirits, but as a source of revenue, as a source of capital, which can be predictably organized and managed, then you can trade in that. So what Weber says is that law takes away the magic of the world. I no longer see the world inhabited by spirits and others. I see it as potential sources of revenue, income, capital, which I can manage. And formal rationality also becomes important for that system in, you might say, law. Because rules then become formally rational, universal, telling you what to do. Because then the capitalist and the merchant can predict that when he sells his goods to someone and makes a contract, then that contract is going to be honoured because the rules say it ought to be the case. So what it does, in a way, is make the normative world flat. It makes the normative world flat. It makes it predictable. So our world, the way in which we live and move about, is always predictable. And the cost of the world being predictable is that it's boring, because we kind of know what's going to happen. And we get, think of it this way, think of here, you all come to a lecture and a seminar, and in a way you could come here and you know what to expect. You know that the lecturer's got to give a lecture on something that's been given beforehand, and he can't just talk about anything. He has to be there for an hour or so. He has to produce and give you that story. But you know that, so you come and you listen and you take notes. And if he starts telling you the football results or how he felt the night before because he was drinking too much or something like that, you can complain or ask for a drink. But it's kind of different. Think of it if the magic of the world, as Vague said, is still there. So when, you know, the lecturer comes, sort of comes, you sit there, people wait, and I come in, smoke a gigantic joint, and then say, well, I know, let's just go somewhere. Let's just enjoy ourselves. Let's talk about films. Then, I don't know, let's play a game of Luna. Then we carry on like this, and nobody knows what's happened and things like that. And it's great fun because nobody knows what happened. Everyone enjoys themselves. But in the end, what you realise at the end of the year, when the exams come, it's not been so great because you don't know anything. It's less boring, but it doesn't help. And the world, you might say, the world of law is that less boring, is that boring world, which at least makes it possible for us to know and predict and live our lives. But in the end, and this is the point, in the end, and the problem about that world is that we can't really live like that all the time. It falls apart because we keep insisting on doing that and brushing out the kind of noise that's coming in from the outside, from behind the boundary that we've erected, that's disrupting it. And we just ignore that and make it as though it isn't like that. So we refuse to make the world different. We make it flat, we make it so that we can predict it. And that's the point of law. In a way, the point of law is to be able to predict, to be able to live, and the price of it some ways, the price of it is that we're never, that we can, if we're not careful, get so sucked into that form of life that we can't, see that there are things to do. Think of the example. It doesn't often happen, but there will be people who will do that. So you're on the bus, and the bus is careering down the road into the city. Everybody jumps off, but you don't jump off and you die. Because you don't jump off because it says you can't leave the vehicle while it's in motion. And you live by the board. And that's a foolish example, but it actually, in the end, quite often happens. People do the law even when they quite clearly see that it's mad. But the problem with all that is that we can never know, or we have a problem in finding out when it is that we should change or break the law. So law creates institutions that guide us in particular ways. So our problem is always this. We need law, but we need to be able to break it and recreate it at appropriate times. We need to be able to have that border there, but porous. But porous in such a way that we can change and move out of it. And that, in a way, is the theme of the next set of lectures. Where do we stand when we live in a world where there are borders but they're kind of porous? How do we live? Do we live in one side of the border and the other and the border is porous? Or do we continually live in a zone of what I call, and I will call later on, the borderlands, in a zone where the outside and the inside are together? If you think of these, I mean, this is a good example of a borderland. We live in Wrocław, Breslau, thousands of other names. I mean, Silesia is itself a kind of borderland, where you're continually negotiating different sorts of identities. My friend, Professor Tobol, who lives in Rajonkovo, which is a small town near Katowice, which was multi-ethnic, said that people there are so confused about their identity, so unsure, that one of the streets was named after, this is a Polish joke, I'm afraid, the Street of the Defenders of Monte Cassino. You getting it? Yeah. I mean, the Polish army mainly has fantastic defeats. And so it's usual that you say that, but actually, this was one where we attacked Monte Cassino and won. It's like the other great thing in communist times, I went to the Museum of the Polish Army. And they had all the glorious defeats of the Polish army, because the glorious victory in the Miracle on the Vistula was not allowed to be shown. But the point is that in these areas, what it's like to live like that is somewhat different. It's living what I call later on in the middle, in transitions, in borders. These are, that's a border which is a transition. There's a border, I'll talk about that later. But it's looking and living in areas where you're continually negotiating where the border is, how the border is to be placed. At the same time, you know there is a border. And that's the kind of problem with law. Because we both need our line, our book, but we also need to be able to understand that the book must be changed at times, but still be the book. And we have this particular position now in Poland. If you think of now, we're talking constitutional crisis, problems of the Constitutional Tribunal, the sorts of problems that are going on. For people who teach constitutional theory, what's happening in Poland is the gift that keeps on giving. Because every single thing that you talk about in theory, about the crises that can come about through constitutionalism and constitutional law, have happened here. And the problem is with both sides to some extent, because there are those who see it as a completely legalistic solution, see and follow the rule of law, the letter of the rules, the rule of the book, and those who sometimes want to just do anything they want, which is what, say, some people say peace is doing or something like that. And the answer, of course, is that the solution has to be both legal and political. But one side wants it political and the other side wants it legal. And the solution is, how do you live? And how do you live in a world where you negotiate those differences and those identities? How can you change that? So that, in a way, is what I've been talking about. What I was talking about is how to live those particular lives. So, there are sorts of two questions involved here. We can stop and we can start talking about them. I want you now to think of ways in which this is the story. There's a novel. What's important here is this, that all our theories, all our abstract theories, moral philosophy, ethics, law, actually are lived out in the world. In a way, what one understands and what one sees as a problem with a theory sometimes comes when we look at the way in which we choose to live it. So, for example, utilitarianism, that theory that says that what is morally good is what leads to the greatest happiness, is problematic, not because technically it's got all sorts of problems involved in it, but actually it's problematic in our societies for a very straightforward reason. Nobody knows what counts as being happy, in general. Everybody is confused about that. And as they try and find that, they fall about. You think, but then again, living the life, and there's a novel in Britain by Iris Murdoch, her first novel. She's an existentialist philosopher and novelist, she was, called I'm too old. Forgotten. I'll tell you later. But it's about. It's called Under the Net. Under the Net. And here, the hero is someone who's a kind of existentialist who says, "I want to live a life which is not caught by the net of rules." And the novel is extremely funny and hilarious. It tells you how that person trying to live that life just fails all the time. It's impossible. And in doing it, it collapses around him. Okay. So, I want now then, can you explain or any of you think about the ways in which we now, in these sorts of societies, think of law as something that is followed, to be followed? What sort of representations are there of legalism, say, of just following the book, or living the book in social life, say, in Poland, in Britain, or anywhere else?
Okay, so now we open the floor for the discussion. questions, critiques. So maybe I will start. I have many questions, but regarding to the last question that you talked, I talked about this symbol of living by the book. Eichmann, as this stereotypical, you know, person living by the book and doing horrible things in the meantime. But when you talk about Antigone, I've never read Antigone in this way. It's very interesting for me because. But I would like to ask you in more details. Do you see the from what you've taught, there is a symmetry between Antigone and Creon, as there stands. But when I read the play, I always thought that there is no symmetry. Because if you look how the characters interact in that play, you can see that I think the Antigone is not the better person. Because she's very ruthless, very, you know, for instance, and Creon is more dialogical. Yeah, he wants to, maybe he's thinking about the common good, and she's thinking only about the rules. He's more willing to, you know, see through the wall some aspects than Antigone. There is no, you know, hope for her. She's so connected with the rules that she is the rules at the end. So I would like to.
Yeah, I think she. I mean, that's an important point in this sense. I think that's right. If you read the Greek play, the Sophocles, then I don't think that's so clear, and it's not obvious. Because if you read the Greek play and Sophocles, he's continuing. Creon is blind and he realizes he's blind later on, and of course then kills himself. But the point is that he latterly realizes that Antigone never does. But in Jean Anouilh's play, and that's why it was interesting seeing them both together. Anouilh's play, set in France, probably about resistances and things like that, actually does make Creon a much better character. Makes it precisely what you said. That is to say, Creon becomes the person who's having to negotiate a difficult position. And he's trying to stop Antigone being crazily ruthless, following her rules and her way of life. And in that play, it's a much more nuanced play. But in that play also, it's never very, very clear what happens. And the question then is this, and I'll let you choose a student to answer it because you know them better than me. What would you do in that position? You're caught in that position. In the play, Tiresias is the person who's the judge almost, who makes the kinds of different decisions. What would you do? What is the way out of that? Is there any way out of it? Is it inevitable that you'll take one side and the other and the place will fall apart? Can borders be borders?
Magic was at the yesterday lecture, so what do you think?
I was rather interested in to ask you about the constitutional crisis you have mentioned. Would you think that there would be a possibility to maybe negotiate between those two sides? What does it mean, living according to the law or living lawfully? What does it mean to fulfill the word of law in a sense you are speaking about? I mean, do you think that we could have democratic institutions which would enable us to deal with such kind of crisis as we experience right now, and maybe to negotiate, to debate, by using the vocabulary you have been using for the law now?
If I may follow up the question, I'm very tempted to now analyze the situation in Poland in these Antigonian terms. Because on one hand, we have the Smolensk incident, when we can also say from the ruling government side, the brother is still not buried properly. There, we don't know details of the catastrophe. There are some theses about some intervention of the third parties. The other side, we have this discourse of the common good. So it's a little bit Antigonian situation now in Poland. So, but that's only a follow-up.
Yeah, I mean, I think that to some extent, of course, the problem, in a way, in these situations is that each side is this. First of all, I think that certain sides and certain have views of law which make it very difficult for them to change. So they'll stick to the law because they think the law is the only thing that guarantees them safety. So in our society, we need the rule of law, and we need that, because if we don't have that, that will destroy us. And you see, that's extremely understandable in post-communist societies, because they have direct experience of what it meant for a kind of voluntarism. And it's interesting that if you actually look at the constitutional courts, as Ms. Sadowski and others did, or some say of post-communist countries, then actually they're more rigid than, say, constitutional courts and others in more established, quotes, democracies. I mean, if you think, okay, things have changed a bit with Trump, there's always a kind of problem there. But if you think of, was a cartoon in the paper of a little child. What do you want to be when you don't grow up? I want to be the president of America. What goes on in America and the Supreme Court and others is actually what would here be seen as a constitutional crisis to some extent. Not directly, not obviously, but the court's clearly in some sense political and in some sense not. But here it's much more problematic because of the memories of before. And for the other side, then, of course, there are all sorts of differing forms of wariness, I think, there. But no side is willing or able to step into a zone where they risk certain sorts of positions.
But the negotiation would require an intervention from the third party in this kind of situation, or we are only left with two parties and they have to...
Well, I mean, sometimes it could be third parties and sometimes they're not. I mean, in real terms, God knows what the answer is in these ways. I mean, what happened in the round table? Then there was negotiations at some stage. I mean, the reality of it, to some extent, is this, that both sides have quite entrenched positions, and neither side, even the side that you might say is on the high kind of support, doesn't realise that actually it's not completely in the right. I mean, you think of what caused this constitutional crisis in the first instance. This platform of Vatelsky actually trying to cheat the system. Because they appointed five judges, two of whom they shouldn't have appointed. And it often happens, you might, in reconciliation cases, where the side that's in the right, quite often, still refuses to accept that it has problems. Think of South Africa and the Truth and Reconciliation Commission there. Tutu and the others fought hard finally to get the African National Congress to accept that some of their people, like Winnie Mandela and others, needed to come before that because they also committed crimes against their own people, for example. I mean, Winnie Mandela necklacing, you know, killing people by putting tires around their neck and setting fire to them. I mean, there was all sorts of things, and both sides have to approach in a way, in that way, for something more. But that becomes difficult because actually, that is also a matter of individual will too. People have to kind of be, in some sense, humble. And that's why I think that it's important when we look at law and legal theory to think of all of these things as being connected with our personal lives as well. Not just the person as the political, but actually, that is to say, in the end, some of these things do come from the fact that we're prepared to make some sort of step. You recall, in the end, if you remember, Rosa Parks, the woman who starts the civil rights movement in America, died recently. And what happened? Here's someone who just refused to move from the seat for whites only on the bus. She didn't know, she just refused. There was no, she was going to fail. She had no reason, she just stopped. And that starts things off, but somebody's got to do that. But in the end, I mean, something is bound to happen. The reality is that the solution is going to be, in some sense, negotiated outside, because the law can't, it can't within itself have the resources to solve it. Because the system is breaking down. It's rather like the story of in the Kafka and the penal settlement. You know, you put your trust in it, you still do it, and in the end it will just grind out that on your body in some way.
Do we have another questions, maybe, from the room? So I will use my position to monopolize the discussion. I only one thing I wanted to ask you, connected with the previous your answer. I was thinking about this. How to, this dichotomy that you draw between this law as imperial court and law as this interaction with the community, how to institutionalize it in the political sense to institution. And I, when I came here, I came with the idea that there has to be some kind of minimum institutional requirements to even to have this community. I was thinking about this, what is called in sociology, this total institution, like prison, psychiatric hospitals, when there is probably, I think there is no place for this community. And I begin to wonder why. In one of your slides yesterday, I saw that this interaction between in this community is connected with the exchange.
Yeah.
And I think in these total institutions, there is no this practice of exchange, because the prisoner, the person, mental yes. sick person, is not a subject, it's only the object of some kind of institution. And if you don't have this practice of exchange, this can be the slightest things. Exchange can be, you know, simply recognition somehow to have this contact. If you don't have this in the institution, and the institution decides whether you have this or not, this place for it, then you will not probably you will have this community either. You will be left only with this imperial court strictly. The most obvious, the even getting further, the most dramatic case of it would be probably concentration camp. Right, and when you don't have exchange at all between the people that are on the different sides of the borders.
That's right.
In that way, what happens? And in a way, and this is the thing, say, about society, like, if you think of, say, how self is constituted, how we become what we are, we become what we are because we exchange, because we connect with other people, and in doing that, we kind of recreate ourselves. We learn what we are. Self is something done from exchanging, from mimicking, from organizing others. You couldn't be anything if you were by yourself, because there'd be nothing from which you could gain, and things like that. And as you do that, you keep growing and keep changing. But once you stop that, once you stop doing those sorts of things, that what happens is you get frozen. You get frozen in time. You become something that you were and that you never changed. And gradually you atrophy. You fall apart. And these sorts of institutions are like that. Then everybody becomes the same, as it were. You think of that, I mean, in a way, it's there is a very strange parallel between organic fascism and capitalism, which is this, that they all, in the end, reduce the society to one thing. I mean, in an organic fascist society, for example, the whole world, the leader, embodies everyone. So when we act in the name of the leader. We are the leader. We are that. It's the body. The body is the whole society is embodied by the leader who is instantiated as that society. But in a society like ours, so there's no exchange because there's just one thing.
But isn't it perversely a society without borders? In this vision of the organic.
There is no, yeah. But then again.
But there is no outside.
Yes, that's right. That's right. And because there's no outside, everything becomes one. But you then think of, say, capitalism, and in that way, what happens with that in the strange? Oh yeah, sorry, no, just before that. It's perverse because communitarianism, the idea that, you know, self is constructed through the community, actually starts acting like that, because though it appears to say that the self is not an autonomous liberal institution, not living with anybody else, it actually has no borders, because when it looks at the community is self-sufficient. And that's your point, perversely. So we're all one. But you think of capitalism has no borders. and in two ways. And well, we saw that with somebody was talking about the migration crisis and other things. And of course, in Britain, we've had this huge problem about Brexit and about immigration and migration. And the thing is, of course, most of the liberal capitalists, most of the Conservative Party who are economically liberal, are in favour of migration. Because, of course, traditionally, the market knows no frontier. The market is expanding all the time. Whereas the left want frontiers, because they want to protect their workers' rights in that way. But perversely, again, in the other way around, is because it knows no frontiers, we exchange all the time, but the exchange is, in fact, never really free. When I give something to someone in capitalist exchange, it's equal commodity exchange. So I always want to get something back, or something that's equal back. So what capitalism does is make everything similar, therefore make everything the same. And everything then becomes just a representation of that same thing. It's gradually, I mean, it's as though we keep exchanging, but because we don't exchange, we don't let, we always demand we get the same equivalent back in money. You know, if you think of everything being defined in terms of money, because we get everything back like that, then we all become the same. There's nothing different. There's no difference anymore. We all become equal subjects under the law, not different people. And you can see that in Europe now. The spread of the market, the free market, has homogenized. I mean, it's interesting, forget about here when they go on to destroy our Catholicism or something like that. Things much more fundamental. When I used to come here, I remember when I came in 1994, 95, 96, I used to come home to Poland, back from Poland, with my suitcase full of bread, kiszone ogórki, twaróg, all the things you couldn't, pierogi, all the things you couldn't get in Britain. And the shops weren't very good, they were full of things that you just didn't have. It was like in Italy, right? There were different things in Italy. Now, you go to a supermarket, it's exactly the same. Except, of course, in each supermarket has a small bit where you have the things you never got. So, for example, in an English supermarket, you'll never get a barrel of sauerkraut. But here you do, well, maybe you did about 3 years ago, maybe you've stopped that now as well. But what I mean is that the whole thing becomes similar. So when you go somewhere else, you get exactly the same thing. It's the kind of, it's homogenized. Because what the market does is make everything the same and equal. And in that respect, people feel annoyed, because of course what happens is their kind of cultural differences become harder. Now in some respects that's both good and bad. But it's still the same. So what you get now is that both ways of looking at it produce, you might say, similarity and identicalness. And what I want to talk about in the next lecture is really, okay, what can we do? What are the political implications of living a life which is somewhat different from the life of living the life where rules tell you what to do, where they define what we are in a way where there's nothing outside of them, where they enclose, as though it's a border, our whole life, and how and what. And we've looked at different examples, both literary and real, about what that makes us. And what I want to do Next time is look at different ways of how we can live in a different world. And the problem is that that's much more complicated. And there are many, many more examples of living the world in this way. But I'll just leave with one other story about, you might say, rules. Because this is really about how I live a life according to rules. I have lived the life of the book so rigidly that I see nothing apart from the rules and I can't think of them as changing. So, in the words of the story of the Cincinnati Kid, I can't conceive of doing the wrong thing at the right time. I can't be creative. If you think, I started off my life, if you've any of you read that, the valedictory lecture that was given out to you, I started my life out as a sort of anarchist. As most of my colleagues, some of whom are now in very high judicial appointments in Poland, did. We were never communists, we were always kind of... And I kind of realised why I was an anarchist. And the reason I was an anarchist is that I believed so much that you had to follow, the rules were things you followed and didn't change, didn't do anything with. That the only appropriate way to dealing with rules was to ignore them completely. I remember, again, this is a story that perhaps some of you might or might not empathize with. When I was a young student, I was still a kind of quite pious Catholic. Still a Catholic, but less pious. Quite pious. And I remember reading the encyclical of the Pope, Humanae Vitae, which still prohibited birth control. And I remember talking with my mother about it. I said, this is crazy, wrong. You know, I might have to leave the church about this. And my mother said, he's crazy, nobody's going to follow this. And I was outraged with my mother because I thought the rules were things you had to follow. And it took me until about 1994 when I became a professor in my inaugural lecture to realise, and my inaugural lecture was about how my mother was both practically and intellectually right. That actually rules can be bent in some sense. So what I thought then, and this is the story of the next lecture, is that anarchism can be defined as creatively breaking the law. So what becomes important about law then is how do we understand creativity? That's what my work has been since then. So we'll talk a bit about that and about how that stands next time.
So this is the good moment to finish. Let's thank our guest for the seminar, who